Okay, hi everyone, and thanks a lot for all the people that helped to organize this wonderful seminar. So the paper I'm going to present today is a joint work with Erin Bouquier from the World Bank and Olivier Sterk at the University of Oxford. I believe that both of them are online or will be online at some point. So Olivier, Eric, please feel free to jump in if you see that there is anything you want to mention. The paper, this study is going to be on the impact of a cash transfer program implemented in Comoros on migration. And so we are presenting both theory and evidence. So let me start with a bit of motivation and with these figures from the UN that show that between 2000 and 2019, there was a sharp increase in the number of people that migrated internationally. It went from 173 million to 272 million. And what has been also very striking in the meantime is that there were many people in surveys that declared their willingness to migrate. There are some estimates showing about 750 million that would migrate if they had the opportunity to do so. So against this background, as you all know, there has been a lot of discussion about the migration crisis. And one of the policy that has been implemented in developed countries has been to support programs to try addressing the root causes of migration and in particular of irregular migration. So for instance, the EU, they set up a trust fund for Africa of more than 4 billion euros that were particularly designed to promote jobs, opportunities in the continent. And also in the US, there's been many programs, many development assistance to support projects in Central America. So this is something, yes, that is very disgusting policy circles. And the key underlying questions for research is whether with development and as people get richer, they migrate more or less from their origin countries. Another transformation that has been very prevalent in recent years has been the wide expansion of cash transfer program. Some figures on this expansion, more than 100 developing countries today have an unconditional cash transfer program, 63 have a conditional cash transfer program, and with the COVID pandemic, many countries are introducing new programs. So there has been lots of research on the effects of this program on various outcomes, such as consumption, assets, human capital accumulation. But there has been much less research on international migration, as I will show. And so this is really the focus of this paper, to study the effect that cash transfers could have on international migration. So in theory, there are four main channels through which a cash transfer can affect international migration. The first one is that cash transfer can increase the opportunity cost of migration, especially if they are conditional on people staying in the home country. Second mechanism is through liquidity constraints, because migration is costly, it can have large upfront costs. And so here the cash transfer can be used as a way to facilitate migration and to finance migration costs. Relatedly, there are also credit constraints in developing countries especially. And so here the idea is that the cash transfer could be used by households that benefit from the programs as a collateral to access credit and to finance migration. And finally, migration is a risky outcome, especially in the case of irregular migration. And so here the idea is that cash transfer can help households to take these risks So in this framework, migration is more seen as an investment that is risky. And so programs such as cash transfer that provide a safety net can help ourselves to migrate more. So the empirical framework of this paper is a field experiment that was conducted in Comoros, the Comoros archipelago. And so the program was launched in 2015 and went through 2018-19. So the program consisted in cash transfers that were conditional on the participation of beneficiaries in public works, so in community works. And so these transfers, they were targeted towards poor households that were residing in poor villages, and beneficiary households received more than $300 over the period. So our strategy to study the effects of this program was to implement a randomized controlled trial. And so we will measure program effects on migration, but also we will try to investigate the different channels that can explain the effect that we observe. Just to give a quick preview of the results, what we find is that the cash transfers increase migration. The increase is quite large because the increase in absolute terms the share of households with migrants by 3 percentage points, and this increase corresponds to more than 30% compared. Yes, we also estimate the income elasticity of migration of about 1 in this setting. Regarding the mechanism, we find that the results are driven by two main channels, the liquidity and the risk constraint channels. We find that the effects of the program is mainly concentrated within households that have a low level of savings at baseline, and that also have a high level of risk aversion at baseline. Regarding the opportunity cost channel, in this context, it did not seem to be active. And finally, it didn't appear from our results that the program relaxed credit constraints. Okay, so we see our paper as contributing to three main strands of the literature. So the first one is on cash transfer and migration, and especially international migration. So there has been only two studies, to our knowledge, that study the impacts of cash transfers and international migration, and both of them are from the Mexico context. There is one study from 2005 that found reduction in overall migration, and there is another study from Angelo Chi that found increase when she focused on labor migration. And the mechanism was through an alleviation of credit constraints. There is also emerging evidence on the effects of cash transfer program on rural to urban migration. This comes from contexts such as Bangladesh, India, and a recent paper in Mali. So the second strand of literature we contribute to is the literature on income and migration. And so there has been recent evidence that in macro level data, there is a clear inverted U-shaped relationship between income and migration. Migration increase at low level of incomes and then decrease after a certain threshold. And then using micro level data, mostly from low and middle income countries, there are some studies that document a positive income elasticity of migration. So here our study used this experimental setting to provide another estimate of the income elasticity of migration. And finally, the last strand of the literature we contribute to is the literature on risk and migration. And so here there is a large literature that documented that risk was an important barrier to migration, that many households do not migrate because migration is risky and they cannot bear the risk. And here we think that we are the first paper to show that a social safety net can increase the propensity of households to migrate. So a quick overview of the talk. So next I will discuss the theoretical framework and then the empirical part, focusing on the background, the empirical strategy, the results, and the channels. Okay, so some theory. So the basic framework of our theoretical model is as follows. So we study the decision process of a household that can decide to send one of its members abroad. And so there are three alternatives in the model, migrating in the first period, migrating in the second period, and not migrating at all. So the main feature of the model are the following. There are two periods, T1 and T2. The households has savings and migration is costly. The migration cost is C. And so the migrants, the household receives income WO if it stays in the origin country, and it receives the income WD if it goes in the destination country. So this is the basic model, and then we have two extensions, one when we add credit markets and one when we add risk to the decision to migrate. But for now, I will focus on the baseline model and then I will introduce these other aspects. So in very simple terms, the model can be expressed in using these four equations. So the equation one and three, they represent the budget constraints of households. And equation two and four represent the return to migration, the expected return to migration. And so very simply, what we can see is that in T1, household migrates if their savings are higher than the cost of migration and if they have a benefit to migrate. And in T2, they migrate if they have enough savings and enough savings in T0 and in T1, and if the expected utility from migration is higher than the cost. So the results can be shown very easily on this graph. So here on the y-axis is the return to migration, so the differential between the wage at destination and the wage at origin. And on the x-axis is the budget constraints, so the savings that households have. And so we can see that migrants decide to, so households decide to have a migrant in T1 if their savings are higher than the cost, and then in T2, if they can save and that the utility of migration is higher than the cost of migration. So then we introduce cash transfer tau that is perceived between T1, that is perceived between T1 and T2. And so these cash transfers relax the budget constraint of households in the second period, so in T2. And here's the households they can use the cash transfer to finance migration. So this can be seen as desired.
Hi, June.
Yeah.
We have a question for Narcisse. Are you interested in the average of migration costs and the average of transfer received by beneficiary? Do you relate the average of those variables?
In the model? Absolutely, yes. It's the average cost.
It's not also level, this is the average cost.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes, sure. So let me now move to the opportunity cost channel. And so here we introduce the fact that the cash transfer is still perceived in between T1 and T2. But is conditional on the all household members staying in the origin country. And so the effect of the cash transfer can be seen on this area. And so what the CAST transfer does is that it goes through the return to migration, WD and W0, and it makes the income in the origin country more attractive to households, so less households send the migrant in T1 to keep receiving the cash transfer. So that was for the baseline model. And then what we do is that we introduce credit market. And so here the idea is that household can borrow an amount B that they, so the amount B can be borrowed in T1 and then it can be reimbursed in T2 with the interest rate R. What we can see in the figure is that more households in T1 migrate. So this is this area. And this is mainly through the budget constraint because now they are able to borrow this amount B. And so more households can finance migration. There is this area that would migrate if there was no interest rate, but because of the interest rate, the utility of migration is lower for these households. So then we study the effect of the cash transfers through this credit constraint channel. And so here there are two main sub-mechanisms. So the first one is on the maximum amount that household can borrow, and the second one is on the interest rates of borrowing. So household can borrow more in T1, and so there are more households that migrate in T1. And also because the cash transfer can be used as a collateral, the interest rate can be decreased. And so there are all these households that also migrate because of this decreased interest rates in T1. And the last feature we add to the baseline model is the fact that migration is risky. So with probability P, a household is successful in its migration to the destination country and receives the income in the destination country, while with probability 1 minus P, it is not successful in the migration and receives the income at origin. So because we assume risk aversion in the model, this is mainly because this has been what has been found in the literature, we find that risk reduces migration both in T1 and in T2, and this operates through the marginal gains from migrating, the returns from migrating. So then what the cash transfers does with risk is that it increases the income of households, and because generally households have preferences that are characterized by a decreasing absolute risk aversion, they are able to take more risk, they are less risk averse, and more households migrate both in T1 and in T2. So to summarize the main prediction of the model, we find three channels through which the impact of the program could be positive: the liquidity constraint channel, the credit constraint channel, and the risk aversion channel, and one mechanism through which it could be decreasing, the opportunity cost channel. So now let me move to the empirical parts. Provide a bit of background on the context. So the program was implemented in Comoros. So Comoros are these very small islands that we cannot really see if we don't zoom on the map. And so it is composed of four islands, three islands that are part of the Comoros archipelago, of the Union of Comoros. So it's an independent country. And one island that is a French department and that is called Mayotte. So as you can see, the island has small in size. They have a population of 1 million in the Union of Comoros and 300,000 in the French department. And they are not very far from the southeast of Anjouan to the northwestern part of Mayotte, it's about 60 kilometers. To provide more historical facts on this context, so historically, there has been strong ties that united the four islands. So they were unified during the French colonization, and they share a similar language, the same religion, they are Muslim, and they have the same tradition. But in 1974, there was an independence referendum, and three islands voted to become independent, while the remaining island, Mayotte, voted to remain with France. And so since 1974, since this referendum, Mayotte has been continuously administered by France, while Comoros has been an independent country and has been pretty unstable over that period. Today, there are large economic divergences between the two areas, and the income per capita in Mayotte is more than 10 times higher than the income per capita in Comoros. What happened in 1995 is that the French government issued visa requirements for Comorians that were willing to migrate to Mayotte. So despite this visa, there are still many migrants that go from Comoros to Mayotte. It's estimated that each year there are more than 20,000 people that migrate from Comoros to France and that are expelled from Mayotte to Comoros. And for the population of the archipelago is very significant. So people usually converge to the island of Anjouan in the southeast, and they take a small boat called Kwasa Kwasa. I will show pictures of Kwasa Kwasa later to go to Mayotte. So these are qualitative quotes and two pictures from the technology that is being used to migrate. So as you can see, these are very small boats and very risky technology. Usually there are about 10 people on the boat, but frequently there are much more people. So it makes even more risky the journey to Mayotte. It is unfortunately a very deadly road of migration. There are no official figures, but all the respondents we talked to mentioned that they know people who died on this road. And there are actually some reports from the French Senate that cites figure of thousands of people dying since 1995. This is also migration technology that is very costly, and it costs between 200 euros and 1,000 euros per person. The cost depends on the number of persons on the boat. Of course, the more persons on the boat, the less costly for one passenger, but also it is more risky. People usually finance these migration flows using their savings or using their income flows. And sometimes they also sell some assets. Some evidence from the qualitative survey also shows that for them, the worst outcome is when they sell valuable property to finance this migration cost, and that the migration is not successful. And in this case, they are in a terrible situation.
Hey, Jules.
Yeah.
So we can consider that the illegal way to go to Mayotte is the only way to migrate from Comoros to Mayotte? Or?
No, no. You can apply for a visa. Yeah. But I didn't discuss it because so the population we study in this paper is very poor. They are the poorest of the poor in Comoros. So even for someone that has a good job, have an administrative job, it's hard to go to Mayotte legally. So I mean, yeah, if you are a poor household, it's impossible.
Okay, the criteria are very high. Okay, we have a question from Alice Ménard too. She's very specific. So can you clarify your assumptions about the capital market and the effect of the cash program introduction on interest rate? What if there is a general equilibrium effect of increasing the interest rate due to the higher demand for migration loans?
Mm. Yes, so this is something that in theory is possible. And so because more people want to borrow money, it would increase the interest rate, I believe. And so in the theoretical model is possible, then the in equilibrium, I'm not sure how it will resolve. But I still suspect that for beneficiaries, there would be a decrease in the interest rate, while for the non-beneficiaries, it would remain the same, the interest rate, or it would increase. So for the empirical part, I think the main threats for our identification would be spillover effects on control households. If they have an increase in the interest rate that they receive, we believe that it is unlikely because the program was national but only targeted 4,000 households. So to have general equilibrium effects, I think it should be on a much more broader scale than that. But this is definitely something that is possible.
Great, thanks for your answer.
Thanks. On the specific program that was implemented in Comoros, so it was the two main stakeholders of this program were the government of Comoros and the World Bank. The program consisted in cash for work opportunities that were targeted towards poor households in 69 villages. The cash transfers were conditional on the participation of one household member to community projects. The daily wage rate for these activities was very low, and between 2016 and 2018, the period we studied, beneficiaries received up to $300. Most of the activities focused on watershed development, so agricultural projects mainly, to limit erosion, for instance. So regarding the empirical strategy, we implemented two-level RCT.
Sorry, Jules, can I ask something?
Sure, yes.
Yeah, so related to the opportunity cost channel, right? So there was any condition for receiving this cash transfer related to the fact that all members had to stay in the country?
No. So yes, this is...
Without such condition then, what is the meaning of the opportunity channel in this
exactly.
Setting, right?
Yeah. That's the point we tried to make in the channel, is that the opportunity cost channel in our setting was not very active. Because what we see is that households, they send someone that is very old and usually a woman to the work, to the public works. While people that migrate to Mayotte, usually they are young. So what is possible is that these households use the cash transfers earned by someone that is the household head or the wife, the household head, to send children to Mayotte. And there was nothing that the program tried to do to prevent that. What I should say also is that there was no explicit goal in terms of migration because this is a subject that is very controversial in Comoros. So implementing agencies don't want to state goals on that too explicitly. But yeah, there was the hope implicitly that it would decrease migration. But in terms of design, it was not very reflected in the design of the program.
And a question of clarification. Did the well pay at the end of the contract or the job, or did they receive monthly transfer, daily transfer?
Yes, another good point I should have mentioned.
So. Machado made it.
Yes, so they were eligible to 60 days of work per year, the beneficiary households, and it was by period of 20 days of work. They were receiving the cash transfers at the end of each period of 20 days. So it was not monthly. The period were kind of irregular, depending on implementation constraints. But yes, the idea was that beneficiary household would receive 60 days of work per year by periods of 20 days, with payments at the end of each of these 20-day periods.
Okay, thanks.
So our empirical strategy is a two-level RCT with two levels of randomization, one at the household level. So there were more people that were willing to participate in the program. So public lotteries were organized. And then at the village level, we had low and high treatment intensity to study spillover effects. So the sample was more than 2,000 households in 62 villages, and the villages are represented on the map by the green losange. So you can see that they are pretty spread across Comoros and across the Free Islands. So in terms of data collection, we collected baseline data in 2016-17. So the survey was after the randomization, so the public lotteries, but before they received any cash transfer. Then we conducted a follow-up survey in 2018, and the attrition rate was relatively limited, and we believe that this is because it was rural households, so not very mobile. And also in Comoros, it's very easy to track people because everybody knows each other virtually.
Did they know that they are picked up when you do the baseline survey? Because you know it as a designer, but did they?
Yes, I definitely knew it because it was public lotteries. Yes, they knew it. And so when we conduct the baseline tests, the balance checks, this is something that could drive differences in balance, but we see that the sample is balanced. So this is not really a concern.
Okay.
We conducted also a qualitative survey between 2018 and 19 to better understand the results that we got. And we also have administrative data on the dates of payments of the cash transfers that we exploit to study the timing of migration.
Also, Jules, sorry to interrupt you. You got about 10 minutes.
Okay, I will speed up. So quickly on the baseline, we find that the control and treatment group are pretty well balanced. Unfortunately, I won't have the time to describe the characteristic of the households. So the attrition rate, as I said, was low, about 4% on average, and it was balanced across treatment groups. And this is the main equation we estimate. So our outcome variable, YI, I will give more detail on that in the next slide, on a treatment dummy and some controls in additional specifications. The standard errors, they are clustered at the treatment level. So how do we measure migration? Here we were concerned about social desirable answers and some bias in reporting of migration. So we were pretty careful in designing the question, and we didn't want, we tried as much as possible to not ask directly, did you migrate to Mayotte? So we have this first variable that is current migration to Mayotte, and here it is collected in steps. So in the first step, we ask for each household member where the member is currently residing. And then if it doesn't live in the household anymore, we ask where he is living. And here Mayotte is one of the choice, but not the only choice. And so we believe that it makes the purpose of the question less silent. And we also have this other question that is more direct, but unfortunately we didn't think about more objective ways to do it. And so here we just asked about return migration. Was there any return migration in the 24 months prior to the survey. So it leads us to analyze two main variables, one excluding returnees and one including returnees. And this is simply dummy variables coded as one if they are sold as at least one migrant.
So, just to know, did you had a lot of newcomers into the household that you surveyed the second time?
From the top of my head, I don't
know. Okay, so sorry.
I don't know, but this is something I can check. So I will focus on these parts of the result. There are these other additional results, but I won't have the time to cover them. So the first step for us was to analyze whether the program was indeed an income shock for beneficiary households, because you could think about substitution effects where people that participate in the program, they give up on profitable other opportunities. It has an opportunity cost to participate in the program. So what we find is that the program was indeed an income shock for households and that the increase employment and income was very sizable. We find some evidence of a small substitution effect for income. So if we exclude the income from cash for work, we find a small decrease in income that is marginally significant. But then once we include the income from cash for work in column six, the program is indeed a sizable income shock. So then we
have Alice wanted to ask a question.
Yeah, that's what I saw. Yes, please go ahead, Alice. I don't know if I need to do anything.
I think I have to unmute.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Oh, sorry, maybe I should have written it, but again, I thought perhaps there is another spillover effect on the control group about income or employment. So I don't know if the program creates jobs or if it does favor the fact that you employ those specific cash recipients. And in which is detrimental to the control groups, I really don't know. Can you explain to us what is happening? Which kind of jobs, which kind of labor market?
Yes, sure. So only beneficiary households could participate in the public works. And the kind of jobs, it's on agricultural related type of work. So reforestation, struggling with erosion. And so it's possible that there may be general equilibrium effects that would create spillover.
Bad or good?
So I believe that it would increase the wage. So actually it would increase the wage of control households. It would be a downward bias in our estimates. We have some estimate of spillover effects using the randomization at the village level, and we find no evidence of spillovers. So again, it doesn't mean that there is no small spillover, but at least the spillovers were not massive. They were not of a very large scale.
Well, thank you.
So the main results of the paper are presented in this slide. So in the three first columns, we present the results for the migration dummy excluding the returnees. And in the last three columns, we present the results, including the returns, migrants. And so we see this 3 percentage points increase in migration that I was alluded to in the introduction. And the effect remain very stable when we include extended controls and island fixed effects. Also, when we include returnees, the coefficient is larger in absolute terms, but it is smaller in relative terms. And this can be due also to some noise with the measure of returnees because it is more direct and more exposed to the reporting bias I mentioned. So this here we estimate the income elasticity of migration. How we do that? So we instrument income by the participation in the program, and then we look at the effect of income on migration. And so we find income elasticity of one when we don't include controls and analytics effect, and income elasticity just below one when we add more controls and analytics effect. So to be sure, when income increases, there is more migration in this context. Regarding the channel, so quick reminder about the different channel I mentioned. So the opportunity cost channel through which there could be a decrease in migration, although as I mentioned, it was not very operative in this context. And then the three other channels that could drive an increase in migration.
Hey, Jules, a question from Sekou. Do you know if there are constraints on the supply of boats used by for migration? If demand exceeds the supply, the program could also lead to higher smuggling prices for Kwasa Kwasa.
Yes, no, exactly. This is true. So we believe it's unlikely because so the increase in migration was 3 percentage points. So the average in the control group was 7.8%. So if we derive then the number of additional migrants caused by the program, it leads to 120 additional migrants that were induced to migrate through the program. So we don't think that 120 additional households would drive such an increase in the price of Kwasa. There are more than 20,000 people that migrate every year to migrants. So again, this is something that would be possible with a program that was much larger. With only 62 villages, we believe it's unlikely. So on the opportunity cost channel, we believe that this channel was not active in this context for four main reasons. So the first one is simply because if it was a strong channel, we would observe a negative impact. What was very striking in this context is that the program was very flexible for us. So they could choose who could participate to the jobs. And so then they could perfectly send someone to the work and send someone else to migrate. So it was not very conditional in the sense of the theoretical model. And then another thing that we can see on this table is that migrants and workers are very different. So in column one, we present some basic descriptive statistics on the people that participated in the public works. And so we can see that on average, they are 40 years old, while the migrants, they are much younger, about 28. 78% of the migrants were female, while the majority of migrants were males. They are also less educated, the workers, and they have less migration experience. So on this table, what we could conclude is that the program increased the opportunity cost of people that were unlikely to migrate, which can explain why this opportunity cost channel was not so operative in this context. There is also some qualitative evidence that suggests that really migration is a decision that is taken at the household level, not at the individual level. And there are many people that finance migration of relatives, both within the household, but also sometimes in the extended family, which could create also spillover. But this is not something we found. We didn't find significant spillover.
Sorry, I hate to interrupt you again. You have less than 5 minutes.
Okay, sure. On the liquidity channel, we conduct a sample heterogeneity test where we look at the effect of the program for households by savings level. So households with low savings or households with high savings, where low and high is below average, the median in the sample. And what we can see is that first, the migration rates in the control group, so the part in brown, is lower for households that have less savings. So this suggests that the liquidity constraint to migration. And then when we look at the treatment effect, so the orange parts, we see that treatment effect is only significant and large for households with low savings. So this really supports the idea that the cash transfers help to relax the liquidity constraints. And then moving to the credit constraint channel, the first simple test we conducted is to look at the effect of the program by the way people finance migration. So there are three main ways through which people finance migration: through savings, through debts, or through the help of relatives. And here we find that the household did not, so the, there was no additional migration that were financed using debts. It was mainly financed through savings and through the help of relatives. Another test that we conduct to look at this channel is to investigate the timing of the effects. And what we see is that the treatment effect we observe take time to appear. And this is not consistent with the liquidity channel because as we saw, it is not consistent with the collateral channel because as we saw in the model, if the program relaxed the credit constraints, it should increase migration immediately when households are eligible because then they can borrow using their entitlement to the project and migrate immediately. So I believe I have a slide on this that shows the effect temporally, an animation, yes. So we have nine time periods, so from T1 to T9, that are semesters. And here we represented the control mean, the migration rate for each time period and the treatment effect for each time period. And so what we can see is that the treatment effect really takes time to appear as cash is being disbursed, and it only becomes significant at the end of the time period. And what I should have mentioned is that here we didn't conduct nine follow-up survey, but in the follow-up survey, we actually asked when people migrated, so the months of migration and the year, and then we reconstructed these time periods to study these dynamics. These are the results in tables. And then on the risk aversion channel, we believe that first, this is a channel that is in theory very relevant in this context because the migration technology, as we saw, is very risky. There is the risk of death and the risk to being arrested by the police and expelled to Comoros. There are many households that that mention these risks, and we believe that many of these households could face what has been called the subsistence constraints, meaning that poverty is so strong that if households invest in something and that this investment is not successful, they would bear very large welfare losses that would be hardly bearable. And then we conduct some heterogeneity analysis by risk aversion level. And so we see that the treatment effect is mainly observed in the sample of households with high risk aversion at baseline. So this supports the idea that the program relaxed the risk aversion constraints.
Sorry, how do you measure risk aversion?
Yes, I think I have a slide on that. Right. So it is a proxy that is derived from a simple choice experiment. So basically households that were willing to migrate at baseline, they had to respond to a question, which technology would you use? And here there was free choice of technology. So in the first choice, it was a very safe technology. So it was I think I have a slide on that to explain. Yes, that was the game. So this was the question that we asked at baseline for households that were willing to migrate. And so all people know what is a quasar, of course, and that the maximum capacity of a quasar is 10 persons. And then they were asked to choose between three types of technology, one that is cheap, but with many people on the quasar. And so this is the very risky one. Technology that is kind of less risky and but more expensive, but not so safe. And one that is very safe.
That makes perfect sense. Thank you.
And then it's the residual from the regression. Okay, so to conclude, a quick summary of the results. What we find is that the program increased migration by 3 percentage points. We estimate an income elasticity of migration of about 1. And we find evidence that the results are driven by the relaxation of credit, of liquidity and risk constraints to migration. There are few questions that we believe would be interesting to study in the future. So first of all, there are these intra-household dynamics that could take place because the migration is an individual fact, but that the decision to migrate actually involves more people than the migrants him or herself. And then there is this question to know whether in the longer run, the effects are stronger because more people accumulate the liquidity to migrate, or whether the effect is smaller because control households catch up with the treated households. And then there is this question of the welfare consequences of this migration on whether the households that invested in migration are better off in this context. So yes, that was all I had to say, and thanks for the nice question.
All right, thanks a lot. We have about 5 minutes for further questions and remarks. Actually, there is one coming in right now by Joel. Maybe it's faster if you just unmute yourself and ask it directly. Okay, there you go.
Yeah, thanks. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Great. Thanks, very nice presentation, very clear. I was just wondering, maybe I missed this, but at some point I thought you were mentioning that you had low and high treatment villages, something like 20% and 40%.
Absolutely.
That you showed. So I was wondering whether you have checked or whether you could check for heterogeneous effects between these two types of communities, in particular, given that you mentioned that these communities seem to be relatively small, so everyone knows everyone, and that could be strong spillover the more treated areas. All right, okay, sorry.
That was the slide on the spillover effects, and so the spillover effects are not significant.
Okay, could you maybe, if I may, just go back one slide from there, I think, because that was the one where you were, I don't know, the slide where you were talking about the employment effects.
Oh yes, it was on the main, because I have the appendix slide and the main slide. So which one was that?
I think when you were presenting the results.
Yes.
Back, yeah.
This one there.
Yes. So so CFW is the cash flow, right?
The cash transfers. Mm.
Okay, right. So you don't find...
So it's the number of days people worked, the cash flow work in the last 30 days.
This type of the subsidized work, the treatment is considered as employment here. And so what this shows is that indeed there don't seem to be big spillover effects. I think this goes back to...
Yeah, here what is important is the control mean, to see whether control household participate in the activities. And there are some contamination of the control group, on average, they participated 1.8 days in the activity. And this is because there were some replacements, some households that were assigned to be treated and then were not interested anymore. So they were replaced.
No, what I had in mind is rather, I mean, it looks like people were aware that this is the kind of one shot, and that was also related to my earlier question. So they had this possibility of up to 3 times 20 days of work. They knew that it was a kind of, I guess, temporarily limited program or help, and with not really much future prospects of better employment chances or something. So indeed, I think that's also playing into the hands of what you were saying, that the opportunity cost in that sense is pretty low, because you know that it doesn't really improve your future prospects on the island, only if the works would really substantially, say, yes, change the structure of your environment, like protecting from floods or other natural catastrophes. But it doesn't seem to have been such a huge infrastructure impact, has it?
Yes, no, absolutely. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks a lot.
Thanks.
Can I ask?
Yeah, actually, I have a remark. I just ask this question and then I give you the floor. So I have a remark on the opportunity cost channel 2 that also connects to what Joel just said, and meaning it is pretty convincing the argument about the collateral channel, but I'm wondering whether if the measure was designed in a different way. Forcing the participants to remain in the islands, whether or not that effect of the financial channel would have been trumped by the opportunity cost channel. And this also adds to what Joel just said about the impact on infrastructure. So that was just a comment of mine.
No, totally. It would be very interesting to study a program or another context where there is really an opportunity cost related, where the program is very effective at increasing opportunity cost.
Okay, so my children came in during the seminar, so I got disconnected for almost 10 minutes. So Julie, if I'm asking something that has already been dealt with, just tell me. So I was wondering, what is the relationship in your view between the timing of the effect, so the sensation that you show, and the risk aversion channel? Because I could think of ways in which, even if it's only risk aversion, the effect would get stronger over time. First, you learn that the program is credible. So in a sense, it's gonna last. It's not something that is gonna disappear. And second, just think about your resources are growing. So your risk aversion, your savings are growing, so your risk aversion is also going down over time. So while, at least in my feeling in the presentation, is that you use these evidence only in relationship to the liquidity channel.
So actually we use this relationship with respect to the collateral channel, and we careful not to put it in the liquidity channel exactly for the reason you mentioned. The liquidity and the risk aversion channel are actually very difficult to disentangle, and they could have the same effect. So for disentangling liquidity and risk aversion, we really believe that it's these baseline measures of risk aversion and of liquidity that are the most convincing. And so yes, the timing of the effect, we put that graph in the collateral channel.
Okay, and just one question. I was thinking about a totally different way to think about risk aversion. So these are young males. Do you have information about the number of siblings? So do you have more young males have a higher, stronger propensity to send out a migrant once they get treated?
Oh, so we have information on that. This is not something we explore. But yes, so for each household member, we know the relationship with the household head. And so we know the age as well, the gender. So yeah, that's something we want to do for sure, like looking at this intra-household dynamics of the effect.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
I have a quick question, if I can.
Sure.
Yeah. So in the paper I read, there was this criteria about the age of your children to be eligible to receive these benefits, right? And I was wondering, I think it was like 15-year-old or something like that. So I was wondering if you have used or you could use the age of the children as a exogenous measure of the duration that these people will be able to enjoy this cash program.
So the conditionality was on the people that could work. So it was only people with old. It was only people older than 15, as you said. And so what we tried to do is to do an heterogeneity analysis with the number of working age people, because yes, exactly as you said, like people with only one person that can work, that is a working age person, for this household, the conditionality is really binding. While for households that have 5 or 6 household members that can work, it is less binding. But then there is, like, this goes in one way, but then there is also another effect that can go in the other way, is that the effect of cash transfers on small households is larger because the income of small households is smaller. So it's kind of hard to interpret this heterogeneity. We don't find a significant effect for this heterogeneity, and we think that it's because there are two direction in which it goes.
And something else, you interpret the fact that people with the effect is not significant for people with high savings, right? And you interpret this as the liquidity channel. And I was wondering what was the connection between the preparation to make and accumulate savings, and the fact that you find this large effect for the people with low savings. Perhaps these people, like in some months, in half a year, they would have accumulated more savings in order to migrate.
Sorry, I'm not sure I understood this.
But we can talk later about it.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, at this point, I would like to ask the audience whether or not there are some other questions. Otherwise, I will wrap up the seminar and introduce next week's speaker. So while I share the screen, let's see if there are other questions. Okay, so I'll go towards the closure. So next week, we will have Lucas Delgado Prieto with a paper called Dynamics of Local Wages and Employment, Evidence from the Venezuelan Immigration in Colombia. But just let me give you a super quick reminder. We are reviewing submissions on a rolling basis. Please check out our website to see the schedule of the upcoming presentations. And as you saw today, we are making this experiment of having panelists. So when you register for the seminar, you can opt in to be a panelist so that you can contribute in a more lively fashion to the discussion. So thanks again to everybody for participating and to our speaker, and we'll see you next week. Thank you.
Thank you, Giuseppe. And to Tipas, of course. Bye.